Today we are moving into the most crucial part of the lesson, that is lesson 19, the emerging political trends of the period from 1977 to 2000. In the previous part of the lesson, we have discussed about the emergence of Congress Party up to 1967, which won continuously elections, which were conducted in 1952, then 57, then again in 62. The first time we got the break of the single party dominance in 1967. From then, again we got the Gandhi coming into power, Indira Gandhi taking over the chair. Again we got her putting into emergency. These all are the series of incidents what we have discussed in the previous time. Now, what happened after emergency? What did she do? What are the political changes? Did she retain her power? How did she come to power? Did she come to power back again immediately, or what happened? What are the consequences of that? Then in this lesson, we are going to deal with all these kinds of main issues. These are the key points or the key issues what we are going to discuss in this lesson. The first one what we are going to concept is, what are the factors that led for the end of the emergency? How many months did India be in the period of black era or the emergency period? Then what are the factors? How are the people during that period? What about the fundamental rights? Are the people happy, satisfied or dissatisfied? What made them to go against that? Next, what about the government formed by Indira Gandhi? When did Indira Gandhi come back to power? What happened immediately after the emergency period? Then moving on to the next, then formation of the TDP in the local states. Why did TDP come to power? What are the factors that forced TDP to get re-emerged or emerge in the Indian politics or in Andhra politics especially? What is the slogan that driven the people of Andhra to vote for TDP and not for Congress? Andhra Pradesh region especially has been a citadel for the Congress up to 1982. Then what are the factors that changed them? Next, moving on to the next topic, we have the Rajiv Gandhi era, establishing Rajiv Gandhi as the new icon of India with a thumping majority. What are the major changes he brought? What were the major challenges that he has faced? What did he solve them? How did he come back over them? What are the factors that led to him or in the favor or in the against of him? Next, moving on to the next incident is Mizo movement. What happened in Mizoram? Who solved the issue? How did it grow into a small incident to a larger incident? These all factors we are going to cover in this lesson. Next, Sri Lankan issue. Rajiv Gandhi has extended his support by sending army to solve the Tamilians problem who are interfering in Sri Lankan issue. The tragic thing is that Tamilians were dissatisfied with Rajiv Gandhi as well as the Sri Lankan people. So what is the end of that one? That we are going to discuss here now. Next, coalition politics. The era of coalition politics was started from 1989. From then onwards, how many parties came to power? What was the issue that happened to? Were the coalition politics successful in Indian context? Or only single party dominance is successful? What changes or what changes they brought in the issue of the political scenario? This we are going to discuss here. And later on we are going to discuss the economic liberalization. What is economic liberalization? What are the factors that made Indian to accept the economic liberalization policies? What are the situations at that moment of time? Did Indians agree it forcefully or did Indians agree it with a happy moment? And we are also going to discuss about the P.V. Narasimha Rao's government. Then we will discuss about the NDA government. How was the coalitions formed? What was the successful coalition government ever led since the independence period? These all are the key points what we are going to discuss in this lesson. So this lesson is going to be a very crucial and an interesting topic, which we are going to cover a period of very large period, that is 33 years of period we are going to discuss in this scenario of the lesson. Now moving on to the first concept, how did the end of the emergency come up? We'll discuss the period of from 1975 to 1985. We'll discuss it now. Moving on to the key concept of the lesson, that is, as soon as India faced the emergency, emergency was a period where Indians have seen the dictatorship truly in alive. There was no opposition party which was left unturned. All the opposition leaders, including the famous politicians who are present even now, were sent to jails and were imprisoned. The situation was that everything was out of control. It's literally that it is that military rule is in focus. And during the emergency period, the fundamental rights are cancelled and the courts were reduced just subordinates to parliamentary, and there is no other alternative except than accepting the orders given by the officials. The officials were made supreme commanders of their executives and they are only instructed to execute the instructions given by the higher competent authorities. In this scenario, later in 1977, the period of emergency came to an end. During this period, even many of them did not dream or ever thought that it would be ended so soon. And with the end of emergency in 1977. Indira Gandhi. She herself declared that she is going to release all the political prisoners and all the prisoners out of the jails, and she is going to contest the elections. So in this period of elections, when she came in to contest the elections, there was a split even in the Congress party itself. Many of the leaders left the mother nation of Congress party and they started their own Congress party. So we got Congress original and Congress the other Congress party also. So now we got the split in the Congress party, as well as we got the new party called Janata party, and we also called SCAD party, Swatantra party, and we have many other parties coming into the scenario. Now moving on to the context, when the elections were held in 1977 after the emergency came to end, except very few leaders like Indira Gandhi also lost her own constituency, home constituency, and the Congress could not retain her power at any longer, and most of the leaders who were contested in the Congress seats have lost everything, and the Janata party came to power with a thumping majority. All the opposition parties came together and fought against the Congress government or Indira Gandhi in personal, because here the emergency period is considered as Indira Gandhi's personal interest, but actually it was a form of government which was headed by Indira Gandhi. But coming into reality, people could not demarcate it or divide that Indira Gandhi versus the other issues. So they have seen Indira Gandhi government versus the other governments, where they have faced the civil rights were cancelled, the prices were shooted up, and all the famous people were kept into prisoners. So in this way, Indira Gandhi was considered as a very bad scenario at that point of time, and she lost her own hometown of elections, as well as she lost in all places, and in except in 9 states, remaining all the other states, she could not retain any of her power, and finally Congress became into the position of opposition and the Janata party came to power. In this way, the return of India towards democracy after emergency was coming into an end. This was a historical incident or a historical period when a nation has faced most severe time the democratic systems have never failed. So many of the questions have raised that is democracy got expired in India, but the 1977 elections have truly made it clear that democracy is still alive and the multi-party system still coexists in India, and there is no single party dominance further. That is only the Congress party. We got all the other opportunities of the other parties to get in the full majority, and Congress reducing itself to less than its half strength, but it could retain its power in the 9 states. What happened in the 9 states? Did the new government accept the 9 states governments of the old Congress government? What are the other steps taken by it? What are the positive steps and the negative steps? We shall discuss now further. Now let us have a clear view on the 1977 elections to understand the elections very clearly, because 6th Lok Sabha elections are the historic elections. The mandate was given very clearly by the people. It is clearly proved that India is a democratic nation. Let us go into the realities of the facts. Like in 1977 elections, the elections were held in 1977. The elections which held in 1977 are the 6th Lok Sabha elections. It is a historical elections. Why do we call it as a historic elections base? For the first time in the Indian history, the new parties like Swatantra Party, Bharatiya Janasangh, Bharatiya Lok Dal, Socialist Party, Janata Party, and in Janata Party we have the key members like Jayaprakash Narayanan and Acharya J.B. Kriplani coming together and motivating. Now the important fact of all these things is that these all parties together fought against a single party, that is the Congress party. That is literally meaning that against Indira Gandhi. All the parties of Swatantra Party, Bharatiya Janasangh, Bharatiya Lok Dal, Socialist Party, Janata Party under the leadership of Jayaprakash Narayanan, it is also known as People's Party, and the man who motivated all the people to stand against the Congress or literally against Indira Gandhi is Mr. Acharya J.B. Kriplani. All these people have worked only with the common binding force is that we are standing against Indira Gandhi's government or Indira Gandhi's Congress, which literally means that they are the people who are showcasing the anti-Indira Gandhi movement, because it is a time period when India has ever seen or witnessed an emergency period, and they have seen the extremities of our ruling system. So they all are motivated to stand against the Indira Gandhi movement, and the historic mandate came for the 6th Lok Sabha elections that Indira Gandhi lost the elections and the coalition government under the leadership of Jayaprakash Narayanan could take over the chair. For the first time in 1977, Indira Gandhi completely got swept out. Only in 9 states we have the Congress party in power. Remaining states of 14 states, Congress lost her power. Now, the important scenario of the coalition politics is that even though these all parties are not binding with the same democratic principles or same idealistic principles, they are having different ideologies. When the situations have arisen about the eminent personalities, they all were together. They forego their ideological differences and they have concentrated together and brought a famous personality into the key positions. Let us see that man, Mr. Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy, who became the Speaker of Lok Sabha on 26 March 1977. Later on, here we have to understand that even though these many parties came to power and different backgrounds, different ideological issues, they have chosen a personality who is of all these things. They have forgotten all their biases of a personality, Mr. Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy, who is an eminent personality here. So he was rose to the position of Speaker on 26 March 1977. Very soon, in less than 3 months of period of time, he has to leave the post and he has to take over the position of the President. So he has taken over the presidentship post on 25th July 1977. And Mr. Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy has made a history here. Like, he was a person who was elected unanimously by all these parties, and not only this, he got the support of Indira Gandhi Congress party also to maintain him the unanimous leader and the President of India, the nominal head. Now, the another important key factor what Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy has played in the history is that he was the only president who worked with a large number of prime ministers in his term or in his tenure. During his tenure of 5 years, he has to work with three different prime ministers because of the coalition politics. India has seen frequent changes of the prime ministers. So let us see here. The first one whom he has to work was Mr. Morarji Desai, who formed the government immediately after this. Then we have to see him working with Charan Singh, who came to power in late 1889 and all these periods. And later we got the period of Mrs. Gandhi regaining the power back in 1980 elections. So in this way, Mr. Neelam Sanjeeva Reddy has made a clear mark in the history by becoming the unanimously elected president, even by the opposition, the only president who was supported by the opposition at that moment of time. And also, he has worked with 3 prime minister candidates. They are Morarji Desai, Charan Singh and Mrs. Gandhi. His role was very vital. Now, what happened after the new government has come? What is the basic principle that they came up with? What are the basic promises that they made to the people? Are they able to fulfill the promises? Did the elected government function for the whole period of its term? Let us see all these answers for all these questions. We'll discuss about them. After the 1997, the historical 6th Lok Sabha elections, the party which came to power was, as we all know, the Janata Party, the coalition party under the leadership of Janata Party. The Janata Party came to power with the principle of restoration of democracy. Now, restoration of democracy was a basic principle which guided the people to come towards or motivated towards the Janata Party. What was their hometown of the Congress Party? Because the Congress was the only party which was dominant in all the elections. But for the first time, the people have left their base and moved on, pitched on to the other party, that is the Janata Party. The only principle which guided them was restoration of democracy. We shall restore democracy in our country. We shall get back your fundamental rights at any point of time. We shall take care of you and the democratic principles. But in reality, in 9 states, Congress could retain her power. Immediately, as soon as the Janata government came to power, the Janata government used the Article 356. What is this Article 356? What is mentioned in this Article 356? Article 356 is officially known as President's Rule. So, using the authority of Article 356, the central government can ask for a report to the concerned governor asking whether the machinery of the state is functioning according to the true principles of democracy or not. On basing on the report of the given by the governor, on the recommendations of the prime minister, the president can cancel the government and impose presidential rule here, which means that on the report based by the governor, if the governor is not satisfied with the constitutional setup at the state level, and if he feels that the government is not running on the basis of the constitutional limits or on the constitutional rules and regulations, he can recommend the president's rule and advise the prime minister basing on a written report sent to him. So using the Article 356, the Janata Party government dismissed the 9 states where the Congress government was in power. The Congress party was in power and suspended the governments and imposed presidential rule and brought their own parties into power, even though in these 9 states Congress had a majority of seats in the respective assemblies. This was a clear objection according to the Indian constitutional limits. But because of the internal disturbances or because of the enmity towards Indira Gandhi's regime, they gave a clear statement that Congress has lost their moral values to rule further. This is a statement given by them, and they cancelled all the 9 states governments where Congress was in power. Immediately, as soon as this went on moving on, by 1978 and 1979, there were many internal disturbances between the local parties or the coalition parties, and they broke down, and immediately we got elections in 1980. In 1980, we got the 7th Lok Sabha elections. Once again, the 7th Lok Sabha elections are historical elections because except in West Bengal and Tamil Nadu, remaining all the states of India, Congress gained back all the states and became the most victorious party with more than 350 seats and giving for Indira Gandhi the thumping majority at any point of time ever since the India's inception of the democratic setup. Now, again Indira Gandhi became the unchallenged leader of the nation. Now, as soon as she took over the national leadership, the prime ministerialship of the candidates, and she immediately paid back the coin of the Janata Party, where the 9 states were replaced by the non-Congress governments, were immediately suspended using the same article of Article 356 and imposed the presidential rule, and later she established the Congress governments there. But finally, the 7th Lok Sabha elections were historical elections which brought back Indira Gandhi with a huge majority. Except in West Bengal, we got the Communist Party, and in Tamil Nadu, we got the DMK Party. Remaining all the states of 1980 period, we got only and only Congress got victorious with a huge majority. Now, coming into the reality, even though after emergency, India has been established as a democratic nation or a truly democratic spirit, or the multi-party system exists in India, but coming into fact of reality that during the period of Janata government or during the period of Congress, when they were suspending the 9 states irrespective of their majority in the seats of assemblies, now they are a binding, or they are moving out of the federal spirit of the constitution. The federal spirit is that the division of the powers between the central and the state governments. The center has to accept some autonomy for the states, but in reality here both the governments acted violently and showed their personal whims rather than the constitutional limits. And in this point of time, many of them expressed the view that the strong center has started to dictate the states. So the DMK, the SAD parties all formed a new front or a small group to showcase that we need a greater autonomy at the state levels rather than only from the central levels, and if necessary we would fight for that. In this way, the new initiative was developed that states demanding the greater autonomy and center becoming dominant over the state regions, even though the states are having majority of seats. That party was not allowed to maintain their power using the Article 356 of the presidential rule. This was against the true democratic setup or true federal setup what Mr. Ambedkar has kept forth for us to be ruled. But in reality, what happened next? What are the regional parties that came to power? What were the binding forces that brought the regional parties into power, leaving the Congress aside. We'll discuss now. Now, moving on to the emergence of the regional aspirations. This was a period when 1980s, the entire India has witnessed the emergence of the new local leaders, especially in the regions of Andhra region, in the Assam region, in the Punjab region, in Tamil Nadu region. Tamil Nadu, already we have MGR influence of the DMK party, which came to power and defeated the Congress in consequently two elections. Now, in this context, we are going to discuss the issues of Andhra Pradesh region. How did Congress lost its power? What were the tactics played by the Congress to retain their Congress leadership in Andhra region? Because the Andhra Pradesh has been a citadel for Congress since 1952. For the first time in 1982, completely was lost. Andhra was no more under the Congress control. It was under the leadership of a new leader. Then we shall be moving on to the Assam politics. What happened? The issue of Assam. Initially, it started between small conflict. Later, it emerged into an international diversity and the National Army of India has to be replaced there. Then later, we shall discuss about the Punjab incident. What happened actually in Punjab? What were the consequences of that? And how did we lose our favorite dynamic Prime Minister because of the reasons which happened in Punjab? This all we are going to discuss now. First, let us move on to concentrate on Andhra politics. What happened in Andhra? Andhra period, in a span of 5 years, the Congress party has changed nearly 6 CMs and it claimed that for every issue, they have to move on to Delhi and get the approval, and they used to get letters or envelopes to the actions to be taken on them. At this point of time, the famous leader or the famous film star of Andhra region, that is Mr. N.T. Rama Rao or NTR famously known, he on his 60th birth anniversary in 1982 declared the formation of TDP. TDP stands for Telugu Desam Party. The TDP stands for the slogan of Telugu Desam Party. Its short form is TDP. And the slogan of Telugu Desam Party or the driving force of Telugu Desam Party was Telugu Vadi Atma Gauravam. It is the self-respect of the Telugu people. The literal meaning of the word is self-respect of the Telugu's intentional values. Now, moving on, in 1982, as soon as he kept the party, within the span of less than 9 months, he came to power with more than 220 seats, which was an historical victory. Ever since, in India, any party could not come into power less than a period of 1 year of time. So this is the greatness of NTR's historical background or the political entry into the Andhra politics. But in 1984, a sad incident took place. Mr. N.T. Rama Rao was not feeling well. He, in order to get his heart surgery to be done, he moved on to USA for a month. Then he was in his operation procedure and all. While in this period of time, he was misled, or the governor misled them, by N. Bhaskar Rao, who was made as the CM of Andhra Pradesh by recovering the MLAs from TDP. He took over the support towards the Congress. At this point of time, while N.T. Rama Rao returned back in 1984, a month later, he could not understand what is going on in the state. He campaigned that all the MLAs are in the favor of N.T. Rama Rao, and they have given it by signing and given in the written form to governor. So immediately he campaigned it for 1 month, and the DMK, the other local regional parties, have supported N.T. Rama Rao at this point of time. Then the government of Central Union Government has immediately suspended the present governor, appointed new governor, and the new governor took over the charge and immediately suspended Mr. Bhaskar Rao and given the chance for N.T. Rama Rao to become the next CM. In this way, there was a crucial play played by the Congress to retain their power in the Andhra region, but it was a failure because at the end of the day, the emerging leaders will not remain only as the statues, or they don't follow the instructions given by the higher authorities, because it literally shows that he has majority in the house, and as majority and the rules of the Indian constitution, the person or the party which holds the majority can make its candidate to be the CM of a particular region. Now we'll move on to the Assam politics. What happened in Assam? What are the major issues of Assam? These all will be discussed just now. Now moving on to the seriousness of the issue here, we have to acknowledge that the issue which was only a conflict between the Assamese and the Bengalis now had it to get the color of communalism. The communal color has been added for the Assam and the Bengalis domination, or the internal policy, or the outsiders and the local people issue. Now it became as a communal color of Hindu-Muslim agitation, because most of the outsiders who came from the Bengal region are settled Muslims of the Bangladesh region. And as we moved on here, the issue later turned on into an incident of anti-Bengali agitation. Later, because the most of the languages which are brought, or the dominant language which is dominating the local Assamese language, was the Bengali language. Now, in order to get the anti-Bengali feeling, later on it developed into a anti-non-Assamese movement. The Assamese are not supported, so they brought it to the anti-non-Assamese movement. Later on they brought the entire communal color, the outsider, the local issue, let it emerge into anti-Bengali concept, then into anti-non-Assamese level. Now finally they came into an issue called anti-India government. So now they are asking that they will need a separate state or a separate community for them to entitle themselves into a separate region, not under the control of an Indian or under the control of a Bangla people. Now, during this period, the young and the dynamic leader who came to power at that moment of time, Indira Gandhi, was assassinated. Rajiv Gandhi took over the leadership of the Congress and the leadership of the nation. With the sympathy of Indira Gandhi's death, he got the majority of votes, and Rajiv Gandhi, with the agreement of All India Assam Students Union in 1984, tried to solve it, made a peace treaty with them, and conducted elections by breaking the present existing government. And then we got the AGP party into power, that is called Assam Gana Parishad. This Assam Gana Parishad emerged as a new political power in the region of Assam region. Now, is the issue solved now? What happened for it? To understand the concept very clearly, we have to understand the issue that in Assam region, we have the many tribal people, because 90% of Assam is covered with the forest region supplied by the water of Brahmaputra rivers. Now, there are four major tribal communities, people like Bodos, Khasis, Mizos and the Karbis. These are the major tribal community people existing in the Assam region. At this point of time, either the issue was not completely solved, the Bengalis and as well as the Assamese, but they started to give special importance for the Assami people, and this community, tribal community people, started to eliminate the other tribal community people, because they started to consider that if only we remain here, automatically the others could not remain here. So they started to kill the people of the tribal communities or force them to leave the regions. So this Bodos or the Khasis or the Mizos or the Karbis people started to move on by killing them, by making them to get afraid, by making them to get scared, to make the other tribal community people to move on or to leave the place and shift to the other regions. So in order to maintain the internal politics to be cool, or in order to reduce the tensions, the government took one more negative step, that is that if suppose Bodos are fighting with some of the tribal groups called X group, then automatically the Assam Gana Parishad government gave support for the Khasis or the Mizos, or some other tribal community was made active by the government itself by supplying arms and weapons for them in order to fight with them. So the tensions continued further and further. Finally, it was a region where it is an adjacent position where we have the China boundary there, where Indian land sharing boundary with China. We have an issue of Dalai Lama security point of view. Later, we had the region of Arunachal Pradesh region where Dalai Lama's shelter was being incepted. And we also have the Bhutan region, another nation. And then we have the Bangladesh issue. And we can't close the boundary of Bangladesh because of the difficult or the terrain conditions, because of the hilly slope regions where completely we can't block the boundaries. At that point of time, Bengalis used to come using that kind of boundaries which are open for them, or used to use the natural gaps which cannot be filled by the government. And this point of time, Indian government took it very seriously, because the agitation which was started between Assamese and Bengalis, which turned into local people and outsiders, which rather turned into communal color of Hindus and Muslims, later it turned into anti-Bengali agitation, then into anti-non-Assamese agitation. Now further it is moving on into anti-India, and they are asking separate state for them. So it means that they need a separate country, and we in the key position of the adjacent, where we have three countries sharing boundaries here, and where are many internal issues to be solved. So the Indian army was deployed there and given the special status of powers finally to curb some of the powers of the people of Assam, to make sure and ensure that everybody lives peacefully. The army has walked in, marched in, and brought a strong, stable system here, and some of the free fundamental rights are being violated here, or special powers has been given to the army in the Assam region to maintain internal security here, because it is covering a region of Bhutan national security, India's national security with China, and also the Bangladesh issue. So the central government has walked in. Earlier it was a small insight of Bengali versus the Assamese. Later it turned into an international conflict, and where the tensions are always high. This was another major issue which was dealt by the democratic government of India in a successful manner. Even today the army in the Assam region has got some special privileges, in not in the other regions, only in the northeastern region. Now we shall move on to the another important and the key factor where we lost the favorite dynamic woman of India, Mrs. Indira Gandhi. What are the steps, or what is the issue that raised her to lose her life? We'll discuss it soon. Now, moving on to the most interesting or the most dangerous ever seen in India under the conflict of Punjab. The conflict of Punjab is that Punjab was a region where it has experienced the untold history of India, and where we lost the entire dynamic lady of India, that is Indira Gandhi. Now let us see first one. The major factor of dissatisfaction for them was that the Punjabi people were asking for a separate new capital, or for Chandigarh to declare itself as the capital of the Punjab, not as a common capital. And they need a special share in the Bakranangal waters. They are asking for a better share of waters for their fields from the Bakranangal project, which was administered by the Union government. Later they are also asking for a majority of the six recruitment in the army, so that they can get their livelihood comfortable for them, and asking a major share in the army. In 1978, that present democratic elected government of Srimoni Akali Dal, or SAD short form, was made an agreement with the Janata Party, or recommendations to Janata Party in 1978, asking the major demands of the Punjab people to be addressed. And it also made a statement that in order to get a perfect picture of true democracy, everybody's voice has to be heard, and the necessary arrangements to be made that everybody feels satisfied and comfortable. But coming into the reality, in 1980, the Congress Party has come into power. Srimoni Akali Dal lost its hold. But in order to maintain its stance, and there was a conflict between Akali Dal and the Congress during the period of elections, and it went into its peaks, like it resulted in the mass agitations, killing of each other, then protesting against each other, rallies and all. In this course of time, we got an emergence of a new leader of the Sikh community, that is Mr. Bindranwale. Bindranwale declared that he is going to fight for a separate state for Punjab, and declared the name of the separate state of the Punjab, that is Khalistan. So Punjab people, or the Sikh community people, started to demand a separate new state called Khalistan, and the leader of them was Bindranwale. Bindranwale was a main key factor in this process of the Sikh community. He, in 1984 period, it was at the peak of this moment of time that he occupied the Golden Temple. Golden Temple, or the temple which is located in the Amritsar. So in order to evacuate these Sikh militants from the Golden Temple, and in order to secure or save the other non-Muslims or the non-Sikh community people, to ensure the security for them, the Indira Gandhi in 1984 allowed the Navy, or the Army, especially the Army people, to come into force under the name of the Operation Blue Star. In the Operation Blue Star, she issued the signature, as soon as she issued the signature, to kill or entry into the Golden Temple of the military, which raised the anger of the Sikhs against Mrs. Gandhi. So in her own cabinet, or in the security personnel, we have a person of a Sikh community who shotted her immediately, and Gandhi fell down in her own office steps. This later resulted in the mass killings of the Sikh community people in late 1984, for which recently in 2005 the Indian Prime Minister Mr. Manmohan Singh felt ashamed, and he bowed on his head, asking for the sorry for the entire nation, and make ensure that in future this kind of actions, or any kind of this and secularistic feelings should not be repeated at any point of time. And coming back to our lesson point of view, like the Congress and Sri Akali Dal made an agreement with Rajiv Gandhi's initiative, came to a compromise formula, and then formed the government here, where the Congress lost the elections. But immediately when the Sri Akali Dal came to power, Longowala was assassinated by the militant groups. Now again it turned into a violent situation where the people can't control the situations. So from the new capital incident, it emerged into the killing of the people. Finally in 1986, we got another leader in April. His name is Akal Takat. Akal Takat also want to form a new state called Khalistan, for a separate state of it. So he formed a national group, a militant group. Especially their target was to form only and only a separate state for the Sikh community in the Punjab region. Now they started to move on from the democratic steps to the non-democratic, into a militant setup, where there is a criticism that these people are completely fueled by Pakistan. Indian government openly criticized that these agitations or movements are completely fueled and weaponed by the Pakistani government. But in reality, what happened is that finally they started to kill the people in larger sections. Only in the year 1991, 1,000 people were killed literally, and they started to do kidnappings, assassinations, and to earn more and more money for their militant group to run successfully. In this way, the agitation went on to move further. By 1991 ending, most of the people like journalists, educated people, politicians, common men, doctors, engineers, the common civilians started to dislocate them or disunite themselves from the Sikh community, and they started to feel that this kind of atrocities cannot be bear further. Then the central government has come up with a new initiative by putting it under the presidential rule and strictly suspending the fundamental rights and arresting whomever they feel it is necessary. And it is also justified by the human rights that if the human rights are given to the constitutional rights are granted for them, it could lead further to mislead the other thousands of people may be killed and their rights may be violated. So at that point of time, the government has to take very serious steps. By late 1990s ending, the conditions in the Punjab has come to a normal level, where it was a dissatisfaction of the Punjab people for asking for the new capital or their capital to be assigned for themselves. It went on to a separate state and then to a separate country. Then the leaders were being assassinated, and it finally took on to the stage of the normal scenario, where we lost our prime minister, many Sikh leaders were killed, army was incorporated into the Punjab incident, presidential rule was brought. So Punjab's initiative was crucially a very historical phenomena till the later part. I hope now it is in the normal conditions and the normalcy continues for the future also. Right. Moving on to the new initiatives taken by the young and dynamic prime minister who came after losing her own mother in the chair, that is Mr. Rajiv Gandhi. The new prime minister was very much influenced by the technological advancements which are happening in the entire world, entire nations. And he observed that India people are having some basic dissimilarities. So let us see point by point here. See, the first thing is, like, in Rajiv Gandhi initiated the peace conferences or talks in the region of Assam. For the first time, the central government went and talked directly with the Assam leaders, the union leaders of All India Assam Students Union Group, and made an agreement with them and went to the elections. For the first time, we have seen an initiative of a leader moving forward and consoling them and agreeing for their conditions. And next, we saw the other region in Punjab, he tried to solve them. Then in the Mizoram region, wherever the conflicts are there, in this way he came up the forward with a symbol icon of peace. And he also sacrificed that his own countrymen against the other nation when it comes to the international politics. Like, many of the Tamilians who settled in Sri Lanka started to fight against the Sri Lankan government, asking them to recognize them as the citizens of the Sri Lankan people. So Indian army was sent under the name of India Peace Keeping Force. So IPKF was sent to Sri Lanka in order to restrain or to fight against Indian men, Tamilians, or in order to maintain peace in Sri Lanka. With this, he lost the support of the Tamilians, as well as after a certain period of time, he got the aggression or the argument saying that why is he influencing or involving in the internal matters of Sri Lanka. So Sri Lanka gave complaint in UN asking them to revoke or take back the Indian army. So in this way, his step, which was taken as a peaceful measure, was lost into a vein, and he has to withdraw the support of the Indian army towards the Sri Lankans, and he lost the support of the Tamilians also at this point of time. And later it was planned, and he was assassinated by the LGTA group, the Liberation of the Tamil Tigers Eelam group, and he lost his life. And in this point of time, once upon a time when he is giving his speech, he made it a very clear statement that Indian development is not up to the mark. In India, there is a lot of corruption, or there are various levels. We have the issue of grabbing the money, the women, the Dalits, the scheduled caste, the scheduled tribes, the uneducated people, the labor people, the poor people are not getting the benefits which are marginalized by the central government. What is a major reason is that he made in his speech very clear that out of every rupee spent by the union budget or the central government, it is the only 15 paisa that reaches the common man. Means the remaining 85%, the bulk of the share, is not reaching to the common man. This is the ideology expressed by Rajiv Gandhi, and he wants that poor people, the uneducated people, the workless people, the rozgar people, and the women should get the major benefits in this scenario of spending the budget from the union government. At this point of time, he want to involve them in the local politics. He want to get them in the Panchayat Raj system, the Gram Panchayat system. It's an initiative to bring the larger community into the system, so that this kind of additional crubs or breakages of the financial things should not be there. And finally, it reaches to the ground reality. At this point of time, there was a serious criticism against Rajiv Gandhi, expressing that it is to curb only the opposition parties, not to gain any hold at any point of time. But actually, his intention is that the product, what he want to launch from there, is not reaching to the common man. The money was spent, not spent wisely. And in 1985, he came up with a new policy of the liberal policies. He's initiated for the first time in the budget, the liberal policy was brought into the Indian context. There were no clear checks against that. And he also told that the Indian government should move on with the new initiatives rather than fixing them or stopping them, restricting them only to the old initiatives, so that we can get or attain development. For the first time, we got the liberalization policy talked or discussed in the nation from the 1985 budget, where he granted the liberalization policy for some of the abroad national companies. And in 19 later, he brought the telecom revolution, and he was the first man to declare that India needs to cope up with the modern technology and the telecommunication system. The revolution, what we are using, the laptops, the computers, the medicines, or the latest mobile equipments, and all these things, where are the advancements or the effects of what Rajiv Gandhi has brought in the telecom revolution in the late 90s. And because of this, we are today going to experience all the latest developments in the technology. He could be considered as a major broad who was a key initiative to bring technology to Indian nation, and initiated the government to take key steps that everybody is ensured, but we get telecommunication system involved in our nation. That is the reason why India today is in the key position on the telecommunication sector at this point of time. This policy was brought in late 1991, but the sad thing is that our Rajiv Gandhi was assassinated in a bomb in the election campaigning, which was held in 1991, and we lost our great leader Rajiv Gandhi in Tamil Nadu, where we could not do anything much. So these were the new initiatives taken by Rajiv Gandhi, and we lost Rajiv Gandhi also in a tragedy. We'll discuss next. Now we shall just have a glimpse on the issues, like how did the rise of the communalism and the corruption enter into the politics or enter into the Indian land. What is communalism? The separation of a particular community of people on any issue is called communalism. We discuss it further in our further lessons. Now moving on to corruption. Giving a money to make any work illegally done is called corruption. How did these two enter into India, and what were their faces during the earlier periods of 90s and later parts of the 90s? What happened in the 1980s after Rajiv Gandhi's initiative was taken up? Now see here, in 1985, the Supreme Court has passed a judgment against the case of Shah Banu. Shah Banu was a woman who got divorced from the Muslim person, and she was ordered by the Supreme Court that she has to be paid the allowance of her divorce. And it is for a not fixed tenure, it is for every period. But in 1986, the government has launched a Muslims Act claiming or fearing that they may lose the votes of the Muslim community, that Muslims has to pay the diverse amount of annulments or any monthly payments for only next 3 months after they get divorced. It is not compulsory for them to pay for lifelong or to ensure the property for them for lifelong. In this way, the communalism entered into the Indian things because they may lose the votes of the Muslims, or Muslims may feel that they are not getting satisfied or interested towards the Indian constitution. And as we move on, the another major incident which is an example for the communalism is that the incident of Ayodhya and the Babri Masjid. The Ayodhya is a place where Lord Rama, historical significance is there for us, that Lord Rama has lived in the region of Ayodhya, and so most of the Hindus want the reconstruction of the temple there, the Hindu temple or Rama temple in Ayodhya region. But the controversial issue here is that the other side of Ayodhya, we have a site of a masjid, which is a Babri Masjid, which was got constructed controversially, and it was an agitation where people destroyed the Babri Masjid. Now, in order to re-ensure that whether to be built a Hindu temple or to be built a Muslim mosque, it was a big issue here. And the Supreme Court in 1986 passed the judgment that masjid can be kept open all the days, but the temple has to be kept only on daily basis, especially on the special days to worship them. And in this moment of time, the farmers started to do agitation with the different leaderships in Madhya Pradesh, in Rajasthan, in Uttar Pradesh region, asking for a better pay of their market output or the market minimum support price extended for their crops output, whatever they are getting it, because their governments are not at all ensuring any such kind of benefits for them. We got the new leaders emerging, Mahinder and Joshi, in different regions. So it is one of the new angle what we got into it. And we also got the issue of corruption entering into the Indian government. There was a serious issue that the Sweden government or the Sweden companies are ensuring or providing guns or weapons for the Indian army at that point of time. But there was a serious controversy that V.P. Singh has taken some corruption in order to issue the legal license for them to the Sweden company. But anyway, this was not proved at any point of time, and V.P. Singh emerged as a new leader after 1989 elections, because in 1989 elections, because of these various incidents, the Congress lost its power. Actually, it retained with a good number of seats, but could not meet the actual required mark of 272 seats which are required to form a government. So the coalition government was established under the leadership of V.P. Singh. What happened under the leadership of V.P. Singh? What were the consequences that were faced? Did V.P. Singh's government allow for the term of the 5 years? We'll discuss them all in detail. Now, what is the condition of India during the period of V.P. Singh government fell down? We'll discuss that. See here. The economic liberalization was the forced thing which Indians are made to accept. So what is the major thing that forced the Indians to accept all these things? See here, in 1991, the V.P. Singh government fell down as soon as they arrest Mr. L.K. Advani. The BJP government, the BJP party has withdrawn the support to the existing, the coalition politics. Then it was forced to go for the elections. These unexpected elections had made the country's economy to fall down immediately. So India needs to maintain a certain amount of foreign currency in the bulk to repay back its imports, what it is taking from the other nations in the form of the foreign currency of US dollars. At that moment of time, India needs a huge amount as loan in order to get back to the original scenario or to maintain India from falling down into the economic depression. As in 1991, the Congress party came into power under the leadership of P.V. Narasimha Rao. P.V. Narasimha Rao took the initiative and spoke with the IMF, International Monetary Fund, the fund which is developed or maintained to give for the developed nations to the developing nations wherever it is required for them in the form of loan, and we can repay it back in the form of small investments. But when P.V. Narasimha Rao was in dialogue with the IMF, he was forced to accept some kind of stringent conditions, the structural changes in the Indian economy. The major changes which were suggested by them are the reduction of the government expenditure. The government expenditure should be reduced at any cost the public policies or the subsidies given on the health, education, medical facilities also to be reduced, and it should be maintained at very low cost. Reducing restrictions on foreign goods. Any foreign national goods should not be restricted at any point of time and should be allowed freely to encourage in competition with the Indian goods. And also opening many markets open for like banking, airlines or mobile banking or net or any other products, whatever is required, to the private competitors, and does not have to maintain only monopolies like in the telephone industry. Only the BSNL network was allowed until that moment of time, but later the private operators are also to be allowed in order to maintain the private sector investment in that point, so that he can get the free flow of the funds. In this way, we got the major changes which were forced the Indians to agree, because we need a huge amount as loan. So Indian government was forced to sign this one and agree all these things. These situations have made Indians to face many tough times, though India did not fall into the economic depression, in fact reality. But as the government has cut down all the benefits which are going to be given for the poor people in regarding to the health, medical facilities and all these things, and no subsidies were provided, so the common man has to bear everything, and he has to pay it back in forms of currency, where the government could not do anything helplessly because it has signed the stringent conditions of the IMF. In this way, the Indian government was forced to accept the liberalization policy by the IMF at the moment of time when we need a huge amount of loan. Coming to the Indian political scenario, the politics has been corrupt by the caste system, then coming to the religious issues, then coming to the coalition politics, then coming to the OBC reservations. All these things have proved that Indian system was getting into multifaceted issues or into great turmoil. But ever since India's inception in the last 50 years, India has faced many challenges and survived and lived and got deeper in the democratic spirit and stable in the economies, and proved to be will be successful in democratic setup. India has seen many coalition politics, India has seen many issues, India has seen many communal disturbances in the nation of the past 50 years, but India still remains a strong democratic country with a stable economy in the last 50 years. It's a great experience of the Indian nationals to be a stable economy.